States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, the first item on the agenda is approval of minutes. The chair will entertain a motion to approve the minutes of the August 25th, 2015 regular meeting of the Board of Education as presented.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carried. The chair will entertain a motion to approve the minutes of the closed session of the August 25th, 2015 regular meeting of the Board of Education as presented.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
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 Any opposed?
Abstain?
No, for the 25th.
Oh, I'm sorry.
No, thank you, but. September 8th. The chair will entertain a motion to approve the minutes of the September 8th, 2015 regular meeting of the Board of Education as presented.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Abstain?
Abstain.
Motion carried. The chair will entertain a motion to approve the minutes of the closed session of the September 8th, 2015 regular meeting of the Board of Education as presented.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Abstain.
Abstain.
Okay, are there any public comments? All right, then we will move on to the public hearing on the 2015-2016 budget. The president of the Board of Education calls the public hearing to order regarding the proposed 2015-2016 budget. And we will now hear from Ms. Kim Anderson.
Okay, good evening. I have the 2015-16 final budget for you. There were a few changes from the preliminary budget. And first, we're gonna start out with looking at our revenues by source. In all funds, a little over $27 million in revenues. And in the operating funds, $25.7 million. And you can see for our operating funds that property taxes comprise almost 83% of our revenues, with very little funding coming from the state, just at a little over 9%, federal 3%, and other local sources around 5%. And then all funds, again, property taxes are the largest component of our revenue, with the other sources making up a very small portion. Revenue assumptions are based on a CPI of 1.5% for the 2014 levy and 0.8% for the 2015 levy. Our interest rates continue to remain at historic lows. General state aid continues to be prorated. Transportation fund also continues to be prorated. The one nice thing that we did, nice surprise for us, was our revenue increased by $612,000. We did receive that CDB grant money, even though the state told us they weren't funding it this year. We did get a check last week for that. So that
cash
was very
it quick.
It's cash. Very good news. And
can
then
you just tell, can you just remind everybody what CDB is?
It was a Capital Development Board, a grant that the district applied for a number of years ago. It took several years for the state to get it. And then with some of the projects that we did this summer, that's money that goes toward those projects.
Excellent.
So, and then the budget also has the issuance of the anticipated $9 million in working cash bonds in there as well. Now, our expenditures by object are listed by all funds. Again, for all funds, $30.4 million, and for the operating funds, $27.7 million. And for the operating fund, salaries are at 58% and benefits at 12%. So again, salary and benefits are the biggest component of district expenses. And then the other purchase services, supplies, and tuition, et cetera, are outlined for you there. And then again, all funds, salaries and benefits, obviously, are the largest component of district expenses. Salaries in the budget are per contract for the WTA. We're still negotiating with WESPA and the custodial union. And then non-support personnel salaries have not been finalized based on contract settlements. The O&M fund, the expenditures include the door hardware replacement at Manning, Miller, the junior high and the high school, the asbestos abatement that occurred at Manning, the architectural finishes at Manning, and then paving repairs and seal coating district-wide. Capital Projects Fund has the anticipated cost for summer 2015 and 2016 projects. And then the district also expanded the dual language program to second grade. We expanded summer school offerings again district-wide this year. We had an addition of a bilingual interventionist. We had an additional psychologist, and we deployed additional one-to-one technology throughout the district. And then there's also tuition costs associated with 18 additional students enrolled at TCD this year. And then this is the fund balance summary for you, and again outlines we are deficit spending this year. A lot of it is planned, especially in the O&M fund for a lot of the projects that were mentioned on the previous slide. The education fund is about a $1.1 million deficit this year. So that will be something that we need to monitor closely through the year and then make adjustments as we work on our five-year plan. Transportation fund also has a deficit of about $98,000, and that's mainly due to our contract with Westway this year. Key considerations when developing the budget: revenue projections are conservative. The expenditures are based on our anticipated needs and exceed current revenues in the operating funds. The budget is aligned with board and district goals to provide educational services to the students and families we serve. And even though we are deficit spending, our fund balance ratios do meet our district guidelines for the fund balance policy that we put in place a couple years ago. So again, though, as we continue on, we need to monitor those and make sure we're adhering to our fund balance policy. Does anybody
okay,
have
the president asks if there are additional comments from members of the Board of Education regarding the proposed 2015-2016 budget.
Just one quick one for you, Kim. I see that we're projecting the CPI to be 0.8%. I mean, do we know that for a fact?
We know that
for a fact. Wow.
Okay. Yeah, and the CPI projections for this year for December are not much better. If we hit a 1.5, we might be lucky, but somewhere around 1.0. Right now, they're projecting somewhere between a 0.5 and a 1%.
Wow. Okay.
So we'll continue to monitor that as well.
Any other comments?
Not necessarily related to what you presented here, but the transportation, the busing, is that going to be a request for proposals?
Yes, we'll be working on that soon.
Okay.
We'll go out to bid, actually.
Okay.
I have just a couple things. First of all, I say it every year, and I'll say it again, I'm very happy for the conservative approach when we talk about budgets, because one never knows what happens. So I, for one, absolutely appreciate that. It's nice to see that we are still maintaining all of these services for our students. I love how you've added the additional things like that we've been able to do with the dual language and one-to-one technology, and not raise class sizes and all that. So I just have to say thank you very much for really watching all of the nickels and dimes, as my grandfather used to always say. This is great. I'm excited to see this. So you hear stories in other districts, things are being cut, class sizes are going up, arts are being cut, and we don't have to do any of that. So I'm very excited.
We've been fortunate to be able to add all these things and stay, you know, and maintain a positive budget. But again,
right,
it's because we haven't spent as much, or revenues have been a little bit higher than anticipated.
Right.
So.
Okay. Anything else from the board?
No.
All right. The president asks if there are any public comments concerning the proposed 2015-2016 budget. The President then declares the public hearing on the proposed 2015-2016 budget is closed. Thank you. Okay, the next item on the agenda is the consent agenda. Are there any comments or questions? The chair will entertain a motion to approve the consent agenda as presented. Number one, personnel recommendation, employment of non-licensed staff. Susan Sapinski, Westmont High School softball coach. Andrew Slaga, Westmont High School assistant boys and girls soccer coach. Jonathan Nolan, Westmont High School assistant softball coach. Two, approval of applications for recognition of schools. Three, approval of September 2015 expenditure report. Four, ratification of August 2015 regular payroll. Five, Illinois Municipal Retirement Fund authorization agent. And six, approval of student tour requests.
So moved.
Second.
And roll call, please.
Ms. Ambrose?
Yes.
Mr. Armstrong?
Yes.
Mr. Johnson?
Yes.
Mrs. Knappus?
Yes.
Mr. Price?
Yes.
Ms. Wilson?
Yes.
Mrs. Charlton?
Yes.
Thank you.
Okay, the next item on the agenda, the wonderful, wonderful thing to do. We are going to hear from Mr. Jack Balderman, the principal of Westmont High School, with some fascinating news to share with everybody. So you have the floor.
Thank you so much. I know there's a Cubs game on tonight, so I'll try to be as succinct as possible. But I'm really excited. This should be a celebration of the work we do in District 201. Everybody, starting with the community and, you know, moving through our school board and our superintendent central office to the great staff at the high school and then the wonderful teachers and staff at the middle school and elementary schools and South School. It really is a team effort. That's the thing that's most exciting. It's a celebration of a whole community coming together and really focusing on what's best for students. And I think because we're so cohesive, it just leads to great things for our students. So I have a little PowerPoint presentation. I'm honored to have one of our students here tonight, one of our teachers, to talk about the work that they've done. And I'll leave some time for questions, but it really is a recognition of all of us coming together. It took everybody to make this happen, and I want to be clear about that. So just it culminates at the high school level. But the first handout that I gave to you, and it's available on our website and also at our building, recognizes the fact that Westmont High School has been ranked by all three national polls as one of the best high schools in America, and obviously one of the best high schools in Illinois also. So I want to give a quick summary, and then you all have a copy of the PowerPoint, but we'll go through all the data. So first of all, for the second year in a row, 99% of our students have completed all graduation requirements within 4 years and walked the stage. That's for 2 years in a row. That's not just a number. That's a real commitment that our teachers and staff make every single day to make sure that all of our students are successful. And everybody talks about all students, but we really live it in 201. And a lot of that is because of the programs we put in place supported by the board. Summer school programs, transition programs, academic support programs, staffing the classrooms at an appropriate level. It's just very powerful. And so we had almost every single student get through graduation within 4 years. And we're on track for something similar this year, but of course we won't know. There's a lot of work to do between now and July. But that really is a representation of our commitment to all students. And it's devastating when students do not make it, what they face for the rest of their lives. So it's so important to us that we keep this trend. You know that prior to PLC implementation, we had the year prior, we had an 88% graduation rate, was around the state average. And our 10-year average was around 90%. So this is significantly higher, and it really is a testament to everybody pulling together. The most improved advanced placement program in Illinois, we'll talk about why that's so important. But also, as you're gonna hear from one of our top students, Adam Dahl, in just a few minutes, he and a friend did a little research this summer. Paul Gordon and Adam did some research, and they're gonna share some of that with you. And When it comes to being ranked by all three national services, there were only 5% of Illinois high schools that made into all three polls. So out of over 700, about 700 high schools in Illinois, there were only about 33 that were ranked in all three polls. And so that's something to be proud of, too. So as you can see, Newsweek, we were ranked as one of America's best high schools there. And the criteria has changed for Newsweek, but it's a pretty rigorous criteria. And to make the first cut, you have to have a performance of your underrepresented students at a certain level. And we made that cut. And then they looked at about 8 different criteria, including graduation rate, AP performance, ACT, SAT, student to counselor ratios in the building, and what percentage of your students matriculate on to 2- and 4-year colleges. So it's a pretty complex poll, and there's been some controversy in our neighborhood about that, but we were included on that list, and we're very proud of that for the first time. The next poll is the U.S. News and World Report. The interesting thing about this poll is that it's 2 years in arrears. So really, even though we were included, it's based on numbers of before we even started to really full force implement our AP program. So we know pretty much where we'll be on this ranking in 2 years, and we think we're going to jet up way up the poll because our numbers are so much stronger because of what we've implemented. And then there's the Washington Post, the Challenge Index, which is the oldest of the ranking systems, and that's where we were ranked in the top 20 in Illinois. And as you'll hear from Adam in a few moments, we really have one of the most improved schools in the nation. So all three polls, we're proud of that. It's very rare. And then there's, on the back of that sheet, there's some results that I'll get to in just a moment, breaking down specifics about how we went there. As I said, out of nearly 700 high schools, only 5% were recognized at all three polls. But the important thing to really, when you dive into the data, if you take out the charter schools, and many of the charter schools, especially the high achieving ones in Chicago, are selective enrollment. They only take certain students. And they take the students who compete at a very high level for that. So they're not really typical public high schools. And I think we are in a different situation from schools that have 1/10 the number of students who are free and reduced lunch. But if you take a look, if you edit those two different ratios out, we're in the top 2% of high schools in Illinois. There's only 2% that are ranked in all three national polls. So I'm really proud of the work the students and staff have done, supported by parents and community and school board and all the rest of District 201. There's something unique that just came out this week, and you have a copy of about 7 or 8 pages from a book called Supporting New Teachers, A How-To Guide for Leaders by author Lynn Howard, who did some research on our district. And I'm sure you're not gonna have time to read it right now, but when you have the opportunity, I really wish you would. From this book are about 6 or 7 pages that highlight the work that's been done at Westmont High School. The closing paragraph on the last page is really powerful when it talks about not only the accomplishments, but the philosophy we have. So to be recognized in this publication, this is not, you know, somebody who's a PR director for our district. This is a researcher and author who sought us out and recognized the work we did. So we're going to get some recognition at a national level for the accomplishments that have taken place. You also have a copy of this book, just a page out of this, but it also highlights, this is a book, it's about time, about planning interventions and extensions in secondary schools, like the one the central office and school board supported when we did academic support time. And so once again, Westmont's name is getting recognized in publications nationally, and that's important. Because I think to go to the next level of achievement, we've got to build that culture and pride and get people, not just in our own community, but across the nation to see the beautiful things that we're doing. So I hope you get a chance. If you want to read the whole book, it's in my office and we have a copy. The author sent us a copy. It's an interesting story because one of our teachers, Christy Parsetich, met her at the Illinois Reading Council and went to the presentation and talked a little bit about what we're doing at Westmont High School, and then she did some research, and then she ended up publishing about the work we're doing. So it's another source of pride for our whole community. At this time, I'm going to call up a really distinguished young man, Adam Dahl, who has been named an AP Scholar with Distinction, which is the first time that's ever happened at Westmont High School. He's just now in his senior year, but he's already earned pretty high honors. And he and Paul Gordon did some research this summer about our progress at Westmont High School, and I'll let him come over here. He's such a dedicated athlete. He broke his leg, but he's still here tonight. Paul wishes he could be here, but he's still at the cross-country meet, so I'm going to turn it over to one of our AP scholars, Adam Dahl.
All right, thank you. Okay, so as Mr. Balderman said, Paul and I came in during the summer to do some research on the Challenge Index. So what it is it's one of the three national ranking systems that he mentioned, and it's published by the Washington Post each year. And it measures how many AP tests are taken per senior. And what that really measures is how challenging the school is. So for us, we wanted to find out how much we improved this year. So we looked at the top 600 schools in the nation and just took the public schools. So we took out the charter and the magnet schools because they're different and are selective. And we found the improvement of each school. So this is the top 10 ranking. Out of all the schools we researched, we couldn't find any school that improved more than us.
This guy's really good at math. He passed.
So we improved from 0.5 to about 3, which is an improvement of 2.543 on the index, and that makes us the most improved public high school in the nation.
Thanks, Adam. So that's just one poll, but it kind of talks about, and...
Oh, Jack's here.
Oh, hey, Mr. Gordon. Come and take a bow. He's fresh from the cross-country meet, so...
Come on over there so we can make sure we get you on camera.
All right.
He rushed from his cross-country meet and to take credit for the work that he and Adam did this summer, so welcome, Paul.
Right, nice and timely, huh?
Thank you.
I should mention that Paul is also an AP scholar with honors, even though he hasn't even completed his senior year yet. So both of these, and they're great citizens. I guess that's the other thing. They're involved in school, and they're wonderful people, most importantly. So we're very proud of them. And thanks for doing your research. So.
Thank you.
Here's just some of the data real quickly. And in a couple minutes, I'm going to have one of our, just one example of one of our many great teachers to come up and tell a story, because it's really... It really emphasizes the power of what I think we're accomplishing, even better than the numbers and the data. But this is important, too, because behind all these numbers is a lot of hard work by teachers, students, support from parents in the community, and, of course, from all of you. So the 10-year average before 2012-13 was 39 passed exams a year, and 12-13 is 29 exams passed. In 2013-14, we had 141. And then this last July, we moved up to 169 passed exams. Now, this is important because the senior class was actually 20% smaller in number, but we had a 25% increase in the number of passed exams. And our target for this year is to go over 200 exams. So we won't only be one of the most improved in the country, but we're looking at being one of the top performing also. The number of AP scholars, and that means students who pass at least 3 exams. Sometimes people criticize the Challenge Index because it focuses so much on how many students are included, which, by the way, there's tremendous research if anybody's interested. It's available in my office for any citizen to see or any school board member. There's also the 2-page executive summary, which you may be more interested in. But if you're interested in reading the whole report, the 25-year study that really talks about the power of AP and how it makes a difference in students' lives, it's the most comprehensive study of its kind, not the only one. But we went from 4 on average over 10 years to 3 in 12-13 to 16 to 33. And we are believing and hoping that we'll go to 45 or more for this upcoming year. So that's some tremendous growth, not just based on inclusion, but how many students have passed 3 or more exams. The number of underrepresented students, where we've received the Advanced Placement Grant from the state for the last 3 years. We will be applying again, but we won't know until November, December whether we get that. But the underrepresented students went from 2 passed exams, or two students passing exams in 2013 to 25, in 2014 to 38, in 2015. So that's really an important barometer also. We don't have the most recent park exam results yet, and so that's our state testing. The last round of results put us on the AYP, meeting AYP, which we're very proud of, and our whole team worked very hard for. And you can see from the scatter plot that we outperformed just about every other regular Title I school in the state of Illinois, and we outperformed most schools in the state of Illinois. The discipline results is also part of what we're doing. We're tracking the out-of-school suspensions. We made a conscious decision to come up with alternative consequences, because if our core technology is to get students to learn, they can't learn when they're out of school. So we consequence our students, we take discipline seriously, and sometimes we have to put them out. But you see the great reduction there. From 125 was the five-year average, to 40, to 21, to 15. There were no fights in our building. That's something I think I'm very proud of. It speaks to the culture that we've established and to our student body, you know. So there's the numbers, and then there's information like that I think is very important. The state administered a survey to all the teachers in the building, and it was an anonymous survey, and they were asked the following questions. Does the principal look out for the personal welfare of the faculty members? I'm very proud to say that 100% of the faculty agreed with that. And the principal has confidence, which I absolutely do. And it's okay in this school to discuss feelings and worries and frustrations. That's a core principle we have, that people are obligated to mention dissension without retribution if they see something that's going to improve our school or be good for our students. The other one is, that does the leadership team provide you with feedback to improve teaching? You see, we have in the 90s to close to 100% when it comes to, are the goals clear? And does the leadership team press teachers to implement what they have learned in professional development? So it's not just the numbers, it's the culture we're building. Now, I could give you dozens of examples, but this one really touched me, and I'm going to ask just one of our great teachers to come up and tell a quick story, because it goes beyond the numbers. But Danielle Wade would have also been here tonight, but she went from dance practice to cheerleading practice, and as I was walking out the door to the board meeting, the cheer coach made it very clear, if you're not at practice, you can't be in the homecoming. So she took practice very seriously, otherwise she would be here. But I'm very pleased that one of our, just one example of many great teachers in our building, Mr. Don Kemmerling here, is going to tell a story that goes beyond the data.
Hi. He's a much better speaker than I am, but I'm going to try my best. And I don't remember that survey we did, but either way. I told a story to Jack about 2 weeks ago, and I learned my lesson because now I'm in front of you telling the same story. But what he asked me to do is come here and tell the story about Danielle, who actually said, don't mention my name. I didn't mention her name. And the reason I told him that is because I was extremely proud of her, and she and I had an interaction that I wanted to tell him about. And so I said, okay, do you want me to just tell the story, or can I talk to AP in total? And he said, talk about AP first and then explain why you're telling the story. So I've now taught AP. This is my third year teaching AP. My first year, actually, I had the two gentlemen over here. And while they're not the best example, because they killed my course, it's tough. It's a very difficult course. And the first 60 students I had walked in and tried to get acclimated, and it was difficult, and they struggled. And I struggled, and I'll be honest with you, I was terrified to teach it, because I knew that I wanted them to pass, I wanted them to be successful, and there was going to be the national recognition, and there was going to be, obviously, the end of the year, did we get there? And so for the first year, it was hard. And then last year was my second year. And while we did really well the first year, I knew, hey, I now know what I'm doing. I think I can do better. I want my students to do better. I want our percentage to be higher. Not that that's the only thing that's the end-all, be-all, but I want them to feel that level of satisfaction. So the first week of school starts, and I happen to have Danielle in class. I'm going to try and say this, by the way, without getting like misty, but we're going to see if that works. And she comes in, and like I think it was day three, she stops me and she says, yeah, I don't think I'm supposed to be in this class. I said, why? She goes, well, I don't know. It's not really the kind of class I normally do well in. I don't really like history. I don't think I can do it. And I remember we had a couple different discussions. And week two goes by, and we do our quiz for week three, and I give them all back. And she looks at her quiz grade, and she's like, she says, is this right? I said, yeah, it's right. It's on the Scantron. She goes, I got a B. I'm like, I know. and I was all excited. But I didn't want to play it off like I was excited because I wanted to make her feel excited. She's like, I never got to be that like that before. I said, cool. So keep it up. And she did. And she worked really, really hard. And she got better throughout the year, and she worked her butt off. And so grades come out. And by the way, you're not in school when those come out. You're actually at home. And so if you have to imagine me on July 1st, like 8:30 in the morning, which is when normally I'd be sleeping in the summer, I can't sleep because AP scores come out. So I'm sitting there, just getting done eating my cornflakes, and I get on the computer and they finally come up. And I won't say that I cheered at all for my students, but I rocketed out of my chair. And one of the reasons I did it was because a lot of the students that I was kind of hoping made it, but just didn't know if I'd done my job, if they were going to get there. And so Danielle happened to be one of those students. And if you are my student, you know that normally I'll find you either during summer, or I'll text you because I have your number because we've been talking about class, or I'll find you the next year and I'll congratulate you. So I didn't have Danielle's number, so I didn't see her until school started. And the first week of school, I happened to see Danielle and she didn't see me. And so I kind of walked up to her kind of sneakily and I said, hey, and she turned and I said, and I went to give her a big high five. I didn't get that far because halfway into the high five, she jumped on me and gave me a huge hug and said, I did it. And I said, I know you did it. That's why I'm high-fiving. And she said, I didn't think I could. I'm trying. Sorry. I didn't think I could. And she was so excited. And I had a hard time, like, not doing this in front of her because I didn't really want to cry in front of her. But I was like, so proud of you. You did it, not me. She doesn't believe that, by the way. She thinks it's all me. I don't believe that. It's all her. And she did the work. And then I said, you know what this means? And she said, yeah, now I got to do it again this year because she's in my class again. So just her faith in herself and or the, I guess, distance she's gone to believe that she can do it is cool for me. And her in class is a totally different kid now because she comes in and she's raring to go and she's smiling. And now she's a leader when she didn't think she could be. So it's, for me, while I was terrified and while they're terrified, it's pretty cool when you know at the end there's like a silver lining. So that's my story.
Wow. It's a great story.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
So as we wrap it up, I mean, the national recognition is important, I think, for a lot of different reasons, to give our school and our students and our teachers confidence. But it's stories like Don, where a student who normally would not be included at a lot of high schools in the AP program, didn't believe in herself, had a teacher who believed in the student, and then achieved, that's what we're really in this for. And there's dozens of stories like that. And even the students who don't pass the exam, I think they're better prepared, and that's what the research says. So it's not just about passing the exams, it's about the experience and the learning and teachers and students fighting together after a big goal. And that's why I'm so proud of what we've all done together. It really is a 201 effort. Everybody played their part. And so the culmination in some ways is being ranked by all three organizations, but that's just a piece of the story. So our goals for this year, we want to continue to pursue 99% graduation rate. As I've said, we want to move the AP scholars up to 45 or more. Remember, we were at 3 or 4 just a couple years ago. The past exams over 200, and we want to increase our ranking in all three national polls. Our priority always is to make sure that our students know the most important thing we teach them is to be compassionate and caring students and just to give their best effort. That's our number one real goal in our school. So we talk to them about doing it because the community and the world needs them to be, you know, working hard and to be leaders and to be compassionate human beings. And we want to achieve greatness because of all the support we get from our community. So you have a lot of the different sheets and the information, and Mr. Freitas, who's here tonight, our new assistant principal, put together a nice piece on why AP is important. It's just a piece of what we do, but the rationale is included in the packet online. And the other thing that's really been powerful is the governor just approved that any student who gets a 3 or more an exam gets college credit at Illinois State Colleges and Universities, which is really powerful for our students. It's a great opportunity. So I hope I stay within the time frame. I tried to. I went over a lot of the great things we're doing. There's other things too with our Change Makers program that is involved in new projects, the Garden Project, where students are growing vegetables for the People's Resource Center to give food to people in need. Our Guidance Department was nationally recognized as an ASCA model of ramp program. So we just really want to say thank you to the school board and the community, and that we are committed to continuous improvement, that even though we are confident we're the most improved school, that doesn't mean our work is done. And we're going to keep fighting for that. So thank you for this opportunity to share the information.
Thank you. Before you walk away, Jack, does anybody have any?
Well, I just wanted to say, you know, when I first got involved with the school board and being on the school board, you would often hear, in our community, you'd hear, you know, a lot of negative about the academic environment in our district, and in particular at the high school, coming from parents and the community, and kind of low expectations. And it was often said, but our kids, they can do anything. There's so many opportunities, and they can be in plays, and they can be in any sport they want to be, and there's fantastic art, and there's this. Yeah, but is what you hear. And it's so nice to move from yeah, but to say yeah, and, you know, as far as the academics go. And so I like to see as much publicity about it as we can, and just the absolute value it has for our students as they move through our district and on to a successful life beyond here. And when you came and you first talked, compassionate and supportive school environment, and, you know, I wondered, you know, how's that going to happen? What's it going to look like? And what are the outcomes going to be? And I think we're all seeing that when the students accept it, embrace it, and challenge each other, these are the types of results that you can expect. And I'm so happy for our students that this is where we're at now. It's been a very long journey for some of us here on the board, and we took a lot of heat. You know, many times it would have been very easy to say, this is just not worth it. But tonight, in hearing all this and getting where we want to be and having everyone involved and everyone take the credit, especially our students, our teachers, our administrators, and, you know, just district-wide, it's very satisfying, and it's a really good night. Thank you.
Thank you.
I will piggyback on Joel, since we've both been in it for the long haul. And one of the things that, you know, everything Joel said was true. We kept hearing that, you know, it's a small community, you really can't do that. But as we talked to people and students and parents, and we talked about, you know, raising the bar, and I think Don's story right there is, if you tell a student they can do it, they can do it. And then when they do it, they have now opened up their whole experience. And now they're not afraid to try the next thing, like your class again, or the next difficult thing that they're going to have to face. And isn't that what our, yeah, see, now we've got, Paul just gave him a high five, so, or fist bump, I should say. So that right there is what it's about. We've got students here who are, you know, still in their clothes and in a cast, who are coming here talking to us. Well, I mean, not their clothes, I mean, they're, how was the meet, by the way? Do you guys do good? Okay. And coming in, and, you know, they can embrace the all of the extracurricular that we offer, but they've taken this work, and I mean, I just have to say, what you guys put together was fantastic, and you did that. And think what you can do with that as you go on, and whatever you do, whatever you choose to do. It's very exciting. I might start getting emotional too, because it is, it means that all the work that's been going on in District 201 has been worth it, because people are proud to say, you know, we're from 201, and it's fantastic. I love it. I mean, I can't say it enough. The businesses, all the teachers in all the schools, the parents, we have fantastic administration in place, and just, it's all, you know, we talked earlier about the money. You know, you have to have that, and if you budget that well, and you look out for grants and opportunities, and it all comes down to successful students, because success breeds success. And I saw a, down my block, I saw a yard sign that said, "An AP scholar lives here." And yes, that is in front of Mr. Price's house. So I love to see the,
Hey, Kaylee.
The posters out there, and we're going to get some more, we're going to get some more posters made and rock the town with that. So I just have to say, it's a great night. It's a great night for you to come and tell everybody about it. That it's been a lot of work. And, you know, I, for one, very much want to say I appreciate what you have done, what your staff has done, and it all comes down to the kids, because they, or I should say the young adults, because they are the ones that reap the benefits. And I think that's what it needs to, what the focus needs to be. That's why we're doing all this, so. I would like to applaud the two of you.
Also, Jack, I want to throw in, you mentioned in the 14-15 year there were no fights. And while that alone is fantastic, to consider that the senior class of 14-15, 4 or 5 years early in the junior high, was in the middle of a school that had so many problems that they were installing cameras on the buses, they were kicking kids off bus routes, kids were having to take taxis, all this. They had assigned seating at lunch. I mean, this was a class among a couple classes in the school that had so many behavior issues that they had to really crack down and do a lot of pretty extreme things. And to say 4 years later, the climate and the culture has changed so dramatically for those same kids is just phenomenal. So, you know, to say no fights is great, but to say no fights with a group that was having problems is amazing. So.
I'll just add one more thing. I had the opportunity to be at the junior high and the high school in the last week, and I had actually left both buildings, and I had called Kevin right away, and I said, I just needed to say something, that walking through the buildings to see the respect between the teachers and the students, and the students and the teachers, teachers and teachers, to see that is fantastic, because that's how you get work done. That's how you have good growth. But it was so overwhelming to me to see that, because it wasn't always that way. Mm-hmm. And to see that happening now, I just really had to take a minute and call Kevin and just say, as a parent and as a board member and as a community member, to see that, just, and I don't think saw that, like it was me there. It was just, it was something I observed, and I thought that was fantastic. So it takes a lot of work to take and change the culture in the buildings, and I think it's there, so.
And I think it also takes a lot of collaboration among the staff to help pull some of these students along, some of your more reluctant learners, some of your students who have more challenges, and really to help motivate them and give them the support that they need to pull them through high school and make them see that they can do it with help and assistance, and not to be fearful of getting assistance where they need it, because you don't get 99% of the people, students walking across the stage if they're not supported in some sort of team effort where more than one teacher is encouraging and fellow students are encouraging. Because if it was, 90% graduation rate and that was kind of the standard, or, there's quite a few students being left behind.
And I one more thing. I mean, I could talk about this all night, but, and I know there's a Cub game on, but I appreciate, Don, you saying out loud here that you were nervous, because that shows, that's a humbling, because as you make changes, the staff has to buy into it too. And I think when you and the staff buy into that, then the students do too. And to actually say that you were nervous because it was something different, I will bet that was probably a huge learning environment as well. And one more thing, could you just, in case people don't get it, could you remind people what 99% means? It doesn't mean just that the seniors walked across the stage.
No, for every student who started with this, within 4 years, all the students had completed all the graduation requirements within 4 years. So 99% of them. Now, what happens is there are two students in this particular class who are entitled to services and education after the 4 years. So they're continuing into, with their education. And the way the state calculates the graduation rate, those students are not included as graduates. Even though they did everything right, the teachers did everything right, the families did everything right, they completed everything they needed to complete, but they continue to stay educated by District 201, which is their right, and that's important too. But they completed all, so that's 99% of the students who went through. The actual way the state calculates is 97, because in our case, those two students are continuing their education, but they completed all graduation requirements. Last year we had 99% and 1% of students were continuing their graduation. So the state official record said 99% last year.
But it's not just seniors. It's
these, no, that's an important distinction.
That's what I'm getting at.
In some states, they start with how many students did you begin with in senior year and how many made them to the end of the year. Well, that's, you know, we're talking about the students who walked in our door as freshmen. Within 4 years, they all but one graduated.
That's pretty amazing. Thank you very much.
Thank you all. I really, it's a great opportunity for me to thank everybody up here to make it happen, and to thank our community too. And I want to echo our students and parents and teachers are just wonderful. They make it happen every day. So
I'm going to finish with this quote that you gave us, and it's your, I'm going to read your quote. Dream big. We are where choices become opportunities. Jack Balderman. So okay. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you.
Right, thank you, Jack.
Just quickly, I'd like to thank Kevin. You know, small giants, Kevin. Small giants. That's what we are.
That's
never
our goal.
Forget that. It's what we are.
Yes.
Before we move on, just very quickly, Jill had mentioned, you know, promoting our success, and that's definitely one of my goals this year, and one of the goals in the district. But Jack mentioned we did, for our AP scholars, we did do yard signs, you know, home of an AP scholar. And then I'm sharing this with the board. The board likes the design. We'd like to do yard signs that, again, promote some of the recognition we're receiving. And then the goal is, you know, and tonight we're celebrating the high school, but there's a lot of great things happening in all of our schools. And as Jack pointed out, we don't have the success at this level. Things aren't working well at the lower levels. And so we want to find ways to promote the good things that are happening in all of our buildings. And then one of our junior high parents reached out to Marie. She in turn gave me his contact information. He's a parent who has a lot of experience with promotional videos. And so Jack and I are attempting to set up, we were hoping to meet this week. Our schedules didn't jive. So now next week we're looking for a date. And then again, not only do something, again, recognize the high school, but the district, and then also each of our buildings in turn, so that we can get the word out there of all the great things that are happening within the district.
Kevin, and I also have to think that this type of recognition really kind of self-recruits top applicants for positions when we have a position available in the district, and that you really be able to be more, you know, selective and really picking from a lot of well-qualified applicants, because I can only imagine that it people want to come and work in 201 as well when they see this type of activity going on.
And yeah, I would agree with that. And if you look at you met some of our new hires at our August board meeting, but definitely when you look at the quality of candidates that we're hiring, there are excellent teachers that are coming on board. So I would agree with that.
I have to just give one little personal thing. I was at a soccer tournament this weekend, and there was a number of families there from Downers Grove, Clarendon Hills, and so there was a lot of conversations because there was a lot of soccer, and so there was talk about they were getting very excited because they were going to start to be offering all day kindergarten. They're just starting to talk about it. So I was able to say, well, we have that in Westmont. And then we were talking, somebody mentioned something about early childhood, that their early childhood was going to expand, and I'm like, done that already. Then dual language program. Yeah, we've done that already. We've kind of gone down that path. And then some of these parents weren't high school parents yet, but they were saying something that they were hearing about some of these great classes that are offered called AP. Well, you want to go talk, see what's going on about AP. It was a fantastic moment to have people, to be in a conversation. And again, I will talk, go back to Joel. He and I have been in this for 9 years. To have that where people talk about neighboring schools. So we're not paying attention to other schools. We're doing our own thing here. And we're rocking it. So again, it is a culmination of, I can't wait to see what the early childhood piece shows as these kids go on and all that. So Jack, you did make a good point that it starts in the younger grades. And so thank you. And thank you, Kevin. All right. Do you have the score of the game there, Gary?
Okay. I'm watching the game.
Presentation of the monthly financial statements, Ms. Anderson.
We have the July 2015 financial statements in your board packet. And this month, the district received $397,000 from the state. And the majority of that was for the fourth quarter categoricals. So in the ed fund, we received $255,000, and in the transportation fund, we received $142,000 of the fourth quarter categorical payments. We also received another installment of the 2014 tax levy in the amount of $362,000. We've collected $11.5 million so far, which is just slightly higher than the past 2 years. So revenues are where they're anticipated to be at this point in the year. And then with regard to expenditures in the ed fund, they're just slightly higher than the prior year averages. And in the O&M fund, and you will hear this all throughout the year, expenditures are higher than prior year averages. We did a lot of summer projects, and so that is one of the reasons why those expenditures are higher. And again, we had some planned deficit spending there. And then in the transportation fund, expenditures vary from year to year based on the timing of the receipt of invoices from our service providers. So, and then the other reports, fund balances, investments, student activity, and statement of position are all attached for your review. Does anybody have any questions?
Okay. And then are you?
Yeah, the next thing we have is the ISB salary compensation report. And this is a report that we just have to present to the board each year and then post it on our website after the meeting. And it has the salaries for all of our teachers and administrators on that. So that's just a routine report that's required now. And then we also have the IMRF salary compensation report. And that, again, has to be presented at a board meeting and then posted on the website. And that's for IMRF employees whose compensation package exceeds $75,000 per year. And that includes, you know, any insurance benefits or things like that that we pay on their behalf. So we only have a few employees that meet that criteria. So those are there for your review.
Okay, any comments? Okay, then we will move on to the action item, adoption of the new high school course.
If I could please, what were Hector Freitas, our assistant principal, who's here tonight, helped together this proposal to facilitate this process? But what we have.
Mm-hmm.
This is AP Computer Science Online. This is an article from Education Week just in the last month. And it talks about the surge for AP Physics and Computer Science. There are almost 50,000 students last year nationwide who took AP Computer Science. And it's a coding course, and it's such a unique opportunity. I think it's potentially a life-changing course for some of our students who are really have an interest in computer science, because they'll learn coding, and we know that the power that, that comes with that. The neat thing about it is the students have to do it online. We were very clear with them. We didn't push anybody into this. We usually recruit very hard to include students in AP, but on this particular course, they're going to have to do 3 or 4 hours a week on their own time. But my hope is a couple things. First of all, the high percentage of students who showed an interest in doing this course are non-traditional students, if you will. There's a good number of students who are, you know, some of them are quality students, and they're all quality students, but some of them have struggled in high school, and they're gravitating towards this because I think it'll be of interest to them. And we can offer this program to at least 20 or more students at a total cost of $3,000. So that includes, you know, the online program, and then there's just a small fee of about $970 for the cost of a teacher to meet with them 1 hour a week. But they have to do the bulk of the work online. There's a good percentage of students who are sophomores and juniors, and I think it's really a great opportunity. So it's economical. We're targeting all of our students, but some of the students who normally would struggle are going to be a part of this. I think this is what they're really, you know, excited about. And we'd like to offer this as a course in our building. And we'll track the data. We'll see how many students follow through and how many students are successful. And there again is the beauty part of the AP exam, that we'll get, you know, the national test, and we'll get results from it next July to see whether students were successful or not. But we're optimistic.
Is this the first online class that's been offered kind of to everybody or anybody who wants to take it?
We have offered students the opportunity through the Illinois Virtual School.
Right.
Kim knows that too, that we to take AP classes online, but this is a little bit different. This company really specializes. They're called Adhesive. You have Hector put together some information about them. They specialize in computer science because they think that the curriculum is uniquely fit to online experience, you know, with programming and coding and everything. So this is the first time we've offered anything like this. And we haven't had the opportunity for students to really take an AP computer science course online. I hope I'm answering your question. But.
Yeah, I just, because I know you've had the virtual school thing for kind of individual students and meeting particular needs here and there, right?
If a student could not fit, because it's a great problem to have in one way, if a student can't fit all the things they want to take in their schedule, sometimes they do have the option to take an online AP government course as an example.
Mm-hmm.
I think our experience has been it's better in those situations if students take it with the instructor and have that daily contact.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, some students have been successful going that route. But this is kind of designed so the students can have a different experience that we don't currently offer in our curriculum. And I think it's a good match between the curriculum and the online experience.
Yeah, I just wonder, I mean, with the number of colleges having classes offered online,
mm-hmm.
that this is something that many students are going to be exposed to after they leave high school. So if there's an opportunity for them to experience it at some point in some manner in high school, whether it's this particular class or another class, I just think it better prepares them for what they're probably going to face at some point.
Yeah, that's an added benefit.
Their post high school education.
So. Yes.
One thing I like, Jack, is what you had talked about is that, you know, when you think of AP classes, you might think of, you know, the top 10% of your school taking the classes. I like what you said about that these are students who might not, that the students that are interested in this are, might not be the students that would take some of the other AP classes. So it's wonderful to see that we're looking at different options for different student abilities. So that's fantastic, and that it's still an AP class. So that's nice to hear. That's nice to hear.
Jack, I'm curious how this, given that it's not taught at the school, how does it impact the kind of statistics like you've had tonight with regards to passing and not passing the AP test and things like that? Does it fall in as though it were a class at the school?
It's The rankings, the three national rankings we looked at, simply, they, well, one of, they look at a number of different factors, but when they do look at AP, what they look at is how many students are taking tests from our building and how many students are passing tests from our building. So this would be calculated into the whole number. There's, we're hoping, now we'll have to see. I mean, it's going to be pretty rigorous, and students signed up, and we got a great rate on this. You know, I'm hoping that every student's successful, but we will see. They're going to have to dedicate 3 to 4 hours outside a week is what's anticipated to be successful. So we'll see if they all follow through. I hope they do. But at the end of the day, any students who are interested will take the test. Depending on how well they do on the test, we'll get those results back, and then it'll be counted into our statistics.
Okay. You'd mentioned, I'm just a little bit curious without going too far into the weeds on it, and it's, you said they're learning a language as opposed to kind of computer science theory. They're actually coding language, that kind of thing, right? So, which is just interesting, because as an AP test, you know, you have physics and math and all the other things where you're doing problems, English where maybe you're writing essays, languages where you're translating one direction or the other, that kind of thing, and using grammar and all. But programming is unique. I mean, typically, like in a college course, programming doesn't necessarily have an end test so much as a project, that kind of thing. I'm just curious, do you know loosely what the structure of the test is? Like, how do you test something like that? Do you know how they handle it?
I know a little bit. They actually do, they learned, I mean, I'm way out of my league here just to be real about this, but they're doing Java and they're doing programming coding.
Okay.
So there's an opportunity for them to, I think that's part of, that's the neat thing. Even, and Hector's a master at this, but on the AP Spanish test, they actually listen to a CD and then they record into a tape recorder and then they're judged upon their ability to speak. So it's not just a traditional pencil and pen test. On the language test, students have to listen, they have to write, they have to answer questions, but they also have to demonstrate their ability to speak. So my understanding is there is a component to this test where they'll be doing some of that, you know, more advanced computer work as part of the exam.
That's very cool. It's very exciting. So. Oh, I'm sorry, I do have one more question. Do they achieve a grade in the class? Does this impact GPA at all?
This is one thing that, you know, we're, this is our first year of doing it. So we're kind of, we want to be fair to our students too. Mm-hmm. And so we're going to, we can monitor how many hours they're actually on the work and what kind of progress they're making, and we'll progress monitor that throughout the year. What we've contemplated is that if the students, based on their performance on the exam, that they'll earn a grade requisite to that. And one of the kind of a neat component that we want to do is, so it would be kind of a standards based. If they perform well on the final exit exam, they will get a requisite grade. If they do fairly well, they'll get a different grade. But here's the thing, for some of the underclassmen, if they go through this year and they feel like they haven't mastered all the material, we want to be more innovative with and say, there's nothing, if you are interested in this and you worked hard but you didn't master all the concepts, then let's review it again next year. And then maybe you'll be better prepared in the sophomore year. And maybe then you'll have the kind of grade that you think that would you know, warrant a high grade. So we're kind of building that into the system. We want, it's standards based, but we're not, we're kind of elongating the time for the students who need it, if that makes sense.
Yeah, cool.
We want to see the students, I mean, I'll be very, but some freshman or sophomore takes a chance on this, is doing the work and really struggles. Well then why not, okay, let's, next year you'll be even better prepared for success.
Good.
So.
Okay.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
All right, the chair will entertain a motion to approve the Westmont High School online AP computer science course.
So moved.
Second.
Yes.
Okay. Can we have a roll call, please?
Mr. Armstrong?
Yes.
Mr. Johnson?
Yes.
Mrs. Notbush?
Yes.
Mr. Price?
Yes.
Ms. Wilson?
Yes.
Ms. Ambrose?
Yes.
Mrs. Charlton?
Yes.
Thank you.
That's fine if Liz wants to talk about the next item.
Okay, the next item on the agenda is the resolution to provide the funding, and Liz Hennessy has just walked in, so Kim said you might want to talk. Would you like to talk?
Sure.
Okay, come on up and...
Good for her.
No.
No, it was unbelievable.
Perfect timing.
Perfect timing.
Perfect timing.
Yeah.
Perfect.
I just have two little things. One is just an updated financing schedule, and then just a brief presentation on the $9 million bond issue that you're going to be voting on the resolution tonight. And
great, so thanks for having me tonight. Oops, I'll wait till everybody gets those. The good news for the
bond...
Could
you just take a moment and introduce yourself again?
Yes.
For those that might not.
Elizabeth Hennessy with William Blair. I work with the district as the bond underwriter, and tonight you're considering a resolution to approve up to $11.2 million of bonds, $9 million of which is new money, and then a portion, the remaining portion, is refunding. So I'm here to give you a quick overview of the bond market, interest rates, what we're expecting, and two options for issuing the bonds. All right, so this is just the update on the market. The good news is the Federal Open Market Committee did not raise interest rates last week, so that's had a very positive effect on our bond market. So we're very pleased about that. Speculation is they may raise rates later this quarter, but it's unclear. It's going to be driven by positive economic data, of which there really hasn't been much. And the other thing to know, and I'm sure you do, is that we're so linked globally. When the rest of the world isn't doing very well economically, it's hard for the U.S. to increase interest rates to try to slow down, you know, inflation, which is non-existent. So I would not be surprised if it's off until 2016 in terms of an interest rate rise, but you just never know. So the district has the ability to issue bonds without referendum. The three types are working cash, life safety, and funding bonds. And the district has already gone through the process to authorize up to $9 million of working cash bonds to address your capital needs. Try to be efficient with my double-sided here. The debt limit is $52 million. So your 2014 EAV times your statutory debt limit less your 7.2 bonds outstanding gives us that number. So the district has lots of statutory bonding authority. Within that, you have a working cash fund bond limit, and that's at $9.9 million. Okay. So this slide shows a picture of the outstanding debt service, which is made up mostly of the only of the 2012 bonds, which were issued for life safety purposes in 2012. Now, these bonds are payable from the debt service extension base, which is part of the tax cap. That goes back to 1994, when this, the tax cap was amended to include non-referendum bonds, where the payments on those bonds did not exceed what was levied in 1994. Okay, so the idea is you can issue bonds as long as you keep your payments around the same as 94. So that debt service extension base number increases by CPI. So last year, in 2015, the CPI was 0.8%. In our projections in 2012, we assumed 1.5% based on an average CPI of around 2.1 or 2.5 4% back then. So it's come down. 2016, we don't know what that CPI is going to be. I'm putting a very conservative number in there, 0.7, but that is just based on some projections. Right now, year over year, CPI is running more like 1.4%, but what we're seeing is pressure on gas prices, and as gas prices decrease going into the fourth quarter, that will influence the CPI. So we're being extremely conservative with 0.7 in 2016, 1% in 2017, and then back to 1.5% average after that. So these are just estimates. We look at various indicators. Money center banks project CPI and Bloomberg and those kind of things. But whatever it'll be, it'll be. But it affects that debt service extension base. So you notice the bonds that you have outstanding right now have about a 30-cent tax rate under the DSEB. The remaining debt service extension base capacity has some small negative numbers in the next 4 years, which is mostly because we got a 0.8% in 2015. Back in 2012, we were projecting 1.5, okay? So it's not a big deal, only in that we're doing a new issue and we'll do some restructuring. We have to do some restructuring anyway to pay interest on the new bonds, so we'll make sure it all fits. But when you have a negative like that, and what you have to do is look to your fund balance and the debt, the bond and interest fund. And typically you carry a fund balance there that should be enough to cushion you for some of these small negatives. But if you don't, you have to look at other funds. So that's why we try to be super conservative when we project that CPI number for future debt. Okay, so the district is looking at 9 million non-referendum bonds. In April we talked, it seems like a long time ago now, but we looked at options so that the district, when you pay off this debt, instead of paying it off as quickly as possible within that debt service extension base constraint, we talked about leaving some room after the year 2022, so about 5 years out, so you would have flexibility to issue additional bonds should you need them for capital projects then. So that's the structure we're reflecting here. The two brief options I want to share with you tonight are the option of the current plan, which is to go ahead with the full bond issue, the 9 million plus the refunding component in November or October, November, in 2015 versus splitting that issue into a 5 million piece in 2015 and come back in January with a 4 million piece. So I'm going to make sure that works with your needs on the capital plan, but by doing that, each of those pieces would be under $10 million. Because right now, if we do it all at once, even though it's 9 million new money, with the refunding portion, it takes it up to 11.2, which is just over the 10 million limit for bank qualification. When bonds issuers sell less than 10 million in a calendar year, the bonds can be bank qualified, which can result in a savings on the interest rate anywhere from 0.05 to 0.2%, because the feds give bank purchasers of these bonds, small issues, they consider them, an extra deduction of interest, which they pass on to you in terms of lower interest rates. So we're going to look at just what the savings would be. The kind of elephant in the room is, gosh, well, what if the Fed comes back and raises interest rates in late 2015 or early 2016? That's a risk, but I'll talk a little bit more about that. So this first option is the 9 million with refunding. So we've got the refunded bonds. We're talking about refunding about 2 million of debt service and stretching it out 3 more years, then combining that with the 9 million so that we've got the debt, which will go out about 15 years to 2031. And you can see the remaining debt capacity comes back in 2022 in the green box. So you've got about a 500,000 of capacity a year there. And then the full capacity comes back in 2031 after all the bonds are paid. Okay.
This is just a picture, a graphic of it. The purple line is the debt service extension base, and the space under that represents that half a million capacity. So that using the same structure, if we do this in two issues, where you get 5 million new money in 2015, and then 4 million in 2016, we have two issues, so it's a little more paperwork and a little more cost of issuance, but it's offset by those lower interest rates. So you can see in this case, the debt actually goes out to 2030 instead of 2031, 1 year shorter, and the capacity is about the same. So if you kind of compare these two options, the savings of doing two issues based on rates today is about $426,000 over the life of the bonds. Okay, so that's some good dollars. And the break even, if you will, how much do interest rates have to go up on the second piece by January, it's going to be over 20 basis points, or 0.20%. And you say, well, the Fed may raise rates, and that usually is in increments of 0.25%. But the thing we have to remember is when the Fed raises rates, they're raising that short-term Fed funds rate that banks borrow from each other and from the Fed at. So it's not the interest rates all the way through the life of the issue. It's just in the first year. So I think it will impact our market when it happens. I'm not sure it will raise the entire yield curve up 25 basis points. I think the effect is going to be on the short end of the curve. So for that reason, I think it's probably better to try to go with the two issues if we find that, if assuming that works with your cash schedule and your bids coming in for projects. The resolution you have before you tonight allows for one issue or two issues. If you read the resolution, you may see some weird language in there that looks like qualified school construction bonds. We put that in there just in case the state of Illinois releases this qualified school construction bond authority that they've been holding on to since 2009. When they did the Reinvestment and Recovery Act. And those bonds are authorized by the federal government, and what happens is the federal government essentially pays almost 75% of the interest costs on those bonds. So it would be wonderful if the district would have access to it. The timing, I don't know, I just put it in there in case. The state has a few other things to worry about right now. So they're probably not thinking about it, but we expect when they do think about it, they will probably give that authority over to ISBE, and then ISBE will go through an application process. So we just included that in the resolution just in case some miracle happens and it becomes available. You could apply for it and then reduce the interest costs further on your bonds. Questions?
Kevin, if we issued two bonds, do we have to start the whole process over for the second bond?
No. Everything's approved in this resolution. You're just doing issuing it in like in two tranches instead of all at once.
And this $426,000 that we would save in interest, is that assuming the lower end of the interest or the higher end of the interest?
Current rates today. Yeah.
And that would work with our contractors and whatever we need to do. Right. So that would,
yeah,
would
we
work.
Yeah, we wouldn't be, it's a two-year project, so we would not need all of the funds up front.
Okay.
So this is something, again, Liz and I can work a little bit more on, because, and we may be able to do a private placement if smaller issue. I knew of somebody who might be interested in buying some of our school bonds, but they couldn't buy all $11 million. So if we break it up into two, we might be able to do something there to save a little bit of money too.
Are you comfortable doing it that way?
I can do either. I want to see if I can get the private placement done, so I'd like to get back to you. I'd like you to approve the resolution, but get back to you and give you my opinion as to whether we should do one or two issues.
And that meets with the timeline that we have here.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Okay, any other questions? All right. Well, thank you very much.
All right.
All right. The chair will entertain a motion to approve the resolution providing for the issue of not to exceed $11,500,000 general obligation limited tax school bonds for the purpose of increasing the working cash fund of school district and refunding certain outstanding bonds of the school district, providing for the levy of a direct annual tax to pay the principal and interest on said bonds, and authorizing the execution of a bond purchase agreement with William Blair and Company, LLC, Chicago, Illinois, or other purchaser in connection with the sale of said bonds.
So moved.
Second.
Roll call, please.
Mr. Johnson?
Yes.
Mrs. Knappbusch?
Yes.
Mr. Price?
Yes.
Ms. Wilson?
Yes.
Ms. Ambrose?
Yes.
Mr. Armstrong?
Yes.
Mrs. Charlton?
Yes. And the second motion, the chair will entertain a motion to approve the resolution authorizing and directing the execution of an escrow agreement in connection with the issue of not to exceed $11,500,000 general obligation limited tax school bonds.
So moved.
Second.
And roll call, please.
Mrs. Knappbusch?
Yes.
Mr. Price?
Yes.
Ms. Wilson?
Yes.
Ms. Ambrose?
Yes.
Mr. Armstrong?
Yes.
Mr. Johnson?
Yes.
Mrs. Charlton?
Yes.
Thank you.
Okay. Both motions have carried. Adoption of 2015-2016 budget. The chair will entertain a motion. Whereas the Board of Education of Community Unit School District Number 201, County of DuPage, State of Illinois, caused to be prepared in tentative form a budget, and the secretary of this board has made the same conveniently available to public inspection for at least 30 days prior to final action thereon. And whereas a public hearing was held as to such budget on the 22nd day of September 2015, notice of said hearing was given at least 30 days prior thereto as required by law, and all other legal requirements have been complied with. Now, therefore, be it resolved as the Board of Education of said district as follows. Section 1, that the fiscal year of this school district be and the same hereby is fixed and declared to be beginning July 1st, 2015 and ending June 30th, 2016. Section 2, that the following budget containing an estimate of amounts available in each fund separately and of expenditures from each be and the same is hereby adopted as the budget of this school district for the said fiscal year.
So moved.
Second.
And roll call, please.
Mr. Price?
Yes.
Ms. Wilson?
Yes.
Ms. Ambrose?
Yes.
Mr. Armstrong?
Yes.
Mr. Johnson?
Yes.
Mrs. Knappbusch?
Yes.
Mrs. Charlton?
Yes.
Thank you.
Okay, superintendent's report.
Okay, a couple items. One is student recognition. Throughout the school year, the district has several different recognition assemblies, and then we also have our graduations. And later on this evening, a list of all those different assemblies will be provided to the board, and board members can select which events they would like to attend as a district representative. And then once that's completed, Rima will send that out to all the board members so that they have a list. And then also each of the building principals will be notified, and they in turn typically will send a reminder to board members, so you can look for that. And then the other thing, week of September 28th is the Spirit Week and Homecoming for our high school. And this year the Homecoming Parade will be on October 1st at 6:30 p.m. I still don't have final information on when staging will take place, and some years we line up at the Amber Grill, and some years we're at Manning when we line up, but I'll find out the information and get that to you. But if you are planning on walking in the parade, if you could let Marie know, and then we do have Rima ordered a banner this year for the board to display in the parade as well. And then in addition to that, some of the other activities, there will be a bonfire on Thursday night, October 1st, immediately following the parade. And then the game itself will be on October 2nd at 7 o'clock p.m. And the high school dance will be October 3rd, again, starting at 7 o'clock p.m.
Okay, great. Thank you. Are there any board reports? Okay. Then, are there any public comments? All right. Future meeting and events. First, Westmont High School College Information Night, September 24th at 7 o'clock at the Westmont High School. Westmont High School Choral Concert, October 7th, 7 o'clock at Westmont High School. Again, the Homecoming Parade will be October 1st, 2015 at 6:30 p.m. And the next day, October 2nd, is the Homecoming Game at 7 p.m. And then the next school board meeting, October 13th, 7 o'clock here at Westmont Village Hall. The chair will entertain a motion to enter closed session for the purpose of discussing collective bargaining, personnel issues, student discipline, probable litigation, security issues, and to review closed session minutes.
So moved.
Second.
Roll call, please.
Ms. Wilson?
Yes.
Ms. Ambrose?
Yes.
Mr. Armstrong?
Yes.
Mr. Johnson?
Yes.
Mrs. Knappisch?
Yes.
Mr. Price?
Yes.
Mrs. Charlton?
Yes.
Thank you.
And there will be a vote after closed session on closed session minutes. Thank you.
Good night.
We are back in session. The chair will entertain a motion to retain closed status for the closed session minutes dated February 24th, 2015, the second closed session of March 10th, 2015, the second closed session of March 24, 2015, April 14, 2015, the closed session of April 28th.
Second closed session.
The second closed session of April 28th, 2015, May 5th, 2015, May 27th, 2015, June 9th, 2015, July 14, 2015, and August 11, 2015, as presented.
So moved.
Second.
And roll call.
Ms. Ambrose?
Yes.
Mr. Armstrong?
Yes.
Mr. Johnson?
Yes.
Mrs. Knobusch?
Yes.
Mr. Price?
Yes.
Ms. Wilson?
Yes.
Mrs. Charlton?
Yes. And the chair will entertain a motion to approve the destruction of the verbatim closed session minutes from September 27, 2011 through March 11, 2014.
So moved.
Second.
Roll call, please.
Mr. Armstrong?
Yes.
Mr. Johnson?
Yes.
Mrs. Knobusch?
Yes.
Mr. Price?
Yes.
Ms. Wilson?
Yes.
Ms. Ambrose?
Yes.
And Mrs. Charlton?
Yes. The chair will entertain a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Meeting is adjourned.
A little bit eager there, huh?